Merry Christmas! We are coming to you unplugged, so to speak, in a different setting in terms of how we are recording our service today, but we have savvy people who are pivoting in this season, and it's a 2020 Christmas. Of course this would happen. So we are delighted to gather with you even in this form, and welcome to worship, and a blessed and Merry Christmas to you. This Christmas morning we are gathered to worship the coming of our dear Christ. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We are called to worship. Jesus Christ is the light of the world. He is the light no darkness can overcome. In the new light of Christmas Day, we are gathered to hear and receive the great promise of our salvation. Let us confess our sins to God in the light of Christ. I have not feared, loved, or trusted you above all things. I have not loved my neighbor as myself. Forgive me, dear Savior, for all of my sins. In the name of the one who has come as a baby in a manger, Jesus the Christ, your sins are forgiven and your life is redeemed. Amen. Made perfect in Christ with the heavenly host, we sing, glory to God in the highest heaven. In Christ, God's word is made flesh and lives among us. Having heard the good news with the shepherds, let us tell of the wonders of God coming to us in Jesus.
First lesson is from Isaiah chapter 35. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad, the desert shall rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus it shall blossom abundantly, and rejoice with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it, the majesty of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God. A shoot shall come out from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide by what his ears hear.
Thank you.
In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day, in the city of David, a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those whom he favors."
Thank you. Christmas to you, especially you, children of the Lord. And I want to start our children's word on this Christmas day at the Advent wreath. Here we are, all five candles lit. We've been waiting for weeks, it seems like, to light one candle, and two, and then three, and then four. And then we know Christmas is right around the corner, but lo and behold, our final Christmas candle, the white candle, is lit. And we are here on Christmas Day. We join the shepherds in this story when they hear of this good news that happened then. They were the lucky ones, I suppose. They heard the news as it happened. They didn't have to wait 4 weeks to light their blue candles or their purple candles, but they got to see the white candle lit right away. That is, they went right away to see Jesus. And so they went with haste. The scripture tells us they went with haste to see this one. And now you, children, you've been waiting, I know, lighting your candles or putting the magnetic candles on your fridge from our Advent at Home kit. But today has come, and perhaps you've been waiting to open presents as well. And here you are. Maybe you've opened them already. I suspect you've opened most of them by now. And you have a wonderful present in the person of Jesus Christ, the best one. And I want to show you a couple presents that I've received that remind us of this. These are all ornaments. I'm going to bring them close to you so you can see them. I can do that now with our camera right in the fourth row. Here is an ornament of the manger scene with the magi on their camels, and it says, "Love came down." Love has come now in the person of Christ, perfect love, which is the forgiveness and salvation that Jesus brings to you. That is one gift that's been given to me. Another is this Christmas ball. After hearing Pastor Anjanette's sermon about her glass ducky that broke, I'm treating this with care. I don't want to drop it. But this has many names of Jesus: Lamb of God, the Beloved, the Life, Savior, Master, Bread of Life. And here it says Jesus, Son of God, the Crown, Prince of Peace, Messiah. And he has come now for you. But how did this happen? Well, a final ornament to show you. The stable, there's Joseph and Mary and a little manger, and the message given in very short form: a Savior is born. And I will add to that message now: a Savior is born to you. For this is why we give and receive presents at all at Christmas, to celebrate that Christ has come. And he has, for your sake. We celebrate this. I want you to celebrate this today as you watch this. Perhaps with a cup of hot chocolate. Maybe opening your presents or playing with what you've received or giving joy for what you've given. But now you know that Christ has come for you. Amen. I invite you to stand as you are able for our third reading of Scripture. Hear the second part of the Christmas story from Luke chapter 2, starting in verse 15. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen as it had been told them. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thank God for it. You may be seated. highest Christmas greetings to you, O favored ones, for you are favored this day. And what does this mean, to be favored? Well, it means you are God's favorites. Can you even believe that? You might think, well, maybe not me, maybe someone else. But the word has come, and it is my job to tell you this, as it was Gabriel's job to tell Mary this. You are highly favored. You are God's favorites, because he has chosen you to receive this news today. Well, maybe you've heard it before. Maybe you're saying to yourself, yes, we do this every year. Or maybe you're hearing this for the very first time. It doesn't matter, because God has chosen you to receive this best news in the history of the world, that Christ has been born for you, that you no longer need to fear sin or death or the devil, because Jesus has defeated them, and now he is yours. So Christmas greetings to you, favored ones, for the highest and most holy one has been born to you this day, and you have been chosen to receive this gift this day. Now last night, out on what I have deemed the south annex of the sanctuary, we celebrated three times in the parking lot on Christmas Eve. And finally at 10 p.m. we celebrated at about 0 degrees. And we heard at least a verse. We did not sing it, but we heard from verse 3 of on a midnight clear. It came upon a midnight clear. We heard about how the birth of our Savior stood in solemn stillness. We looked at this third verse, which describes what life is like in this old world, what it was like for Mary and Joseph, what it was like for the shepherds, and what it is often like for us. That is, as the writer of the hymn describes, how life's crushing load bears us low. And indeed it does. We hear at the beginning of our gospel reading these familiar words. In those days, a decree went up from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. Right off the bat, a word of the law. Mary and Joseph were directed to go back to Bethlehem. This was not a choice for them or a vacation. It was the law that said, you must go. And so they did. They were under it. And indeed, this is how Christ is brought into the world to fulfill the scriptures of old, that he would be born in Bethlehem. Well, Mary and Joseph weren't living in Bethlehem. But God saw, even through the law of Emperor Augustus, that it would come this way. And so they went, and Jesus was born where the prophets of old had said he would be, in Bethlehem. But we're reminded here that Christ is born under the weight of the law, the crushing load that we feel as well. We looked at this last night, this verse 3, and I wanted to take a short look at the other verses, and we'll sing this hymn soon enough. It came upon a midnight clear. For a while under the load of the law, this word came into the world. We sing, it came upon a midnight clear, that the angels brought this message, this word, peace on earth, goodwill to all, from heaven's all-gracious King. And while the world stood in solemn stillness, the song went out, as it does today, to tell all of our neighbors that Christ has been born for them. And verse 2 sings this song, that the music floats with the angels' wings. Again, we are reminded of the sad and lowly plains, but the song goes out over them, and the angels share this message of peace and goodwill. And then we get to verse 3, which is another reminder of this load of the law. But halfway through, it changes. And it says, look now. Look now. For glad and golden hours come swiftly on the wing. And now on Christmas Day, we are there. I look out our windows, and it is golden outside. The sun is up. A little chilly, perhaps. But they've come. Christ has come. And this news has come to you. And we make it to verse 4. And we're brought back to where we started. For lo, the days are hastening on by the prophets seen of old. And what did we hear from our prophet Isaiah? Well, two words. That the wilderness, the dry land shall be glad. That which was barren shall be fruitful because of Christ. And that a shoot shall come up out of the stump of Jesse. And a branch shall grow out of its roots. Now, we had a tree in our backyard, and it was buried in our backyard. That was part of the landscape when we bought the house 8 years ago. The tree was about 10 feet from the house. It was about this big around, and it provided beautiful shade. The previous owners had built a deck around the tree, which we thought was novel. But there were some difficulties with this design. As cool as it was to have a tree growing right through the deck, the tree was alive and kept growing bigger this way and closer to the house. And after a few years, I began to worry, what if this tree fell? It was a box elder tree, which is a strong tree, but they have a tendency, my brother tells me, because they are have a high sugar content, of rotting from the inside. And I began to notice a crack in our basement wall. I began to worry. The tree was pushing the deck into the wall, and I thought, I need to cut this deck away. And eventually I came to the conclusion, after looking at the tree a little closer, that it indeed was hollow. And this large box elder tree needed to be cut down. And so it was. And there's a big stump under our deck now. A hollow stump. But you know, even out of a hollow stump, there are branches that all summer have wanted to poke up through the deck boards. And I've been reminded of this prophecy, that from the stump of Jesse, a branch shall grow out of its roots. God designed trees this way, that even when they've been cut, there is life that wants to come up. But the ultimate branch now is not David, but Christ, who comes from the long dead branch, stump of Jesse. Christ now comes to you. He's born in this most amazing way, and he has the Holy Spirit with him, which means he gives you faith. And so we sing this fourth verse, lo, the days are hastening on, with haste the days have come, that the prophets have told us about. And now these days are here, for Christ has come. Been waiting a long time for this. I can tell you that our kids at home have been waiting a long time for this day, and this morning finally were able to open their presents, and boy, were they excited. They raced down the stairway, still waiting until everyone was awake and present, and then the wrapping paper flew. And what fun it is to see the joy of unmitigated excitement for things anticipated and things unanticipated under the wrapping paper. And now I share this joy with you. You may anticipate some of the gifts Christ brings you, but you have no idea how deeply they will affect you, how much peace they will bring you in the coming years and into eternity. But he has come, you favored ones, not because of anything you deserved. Mary did not deserve what she received. The shepherds did not deserve to be the first to hear this, but God chose them. And now you too do not deserve this. But Christ has come to be sure that it is yours. So I say to you, Merry Christmas on this Christmas day. Amen. I invite you to stand as you are able as we sing this hymn. Let's not just talk about it, but we'll sing it.
True God from true God, begotten and not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We pause to receive our offerings to God's work in the world through the gift of Jesus Christ. And in this Christmas season, our offerings are dedicated to two organizations, The Landy, which is a local organization that helps the homeless in our community, and then ELCA World Hunger. And we give thanks for the ways we can serve and respond to God's many blessings with the gifts we offer. We sing.
Thank you.
Let us pray together the prayer our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now may the Lord, who has come all the way to you this Christmas day, bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thanks be to God.